Hello guys, what's up? Welcome back. This is AJ. So a few days back, I showed you how to use object pooling and we implemented it on a ammo pickup. Maybe you have already figured out a way to implement it on a projectiles as well, but I haven't really showed you that. So this is going to be a video dedicated to that. So if you haven't watched my video on object pooling, please go watch that and then come back here. So without further ado, let's get started. Firstly, in a pool manager, now we have only one prefab, which is our ammo pickup. So I'm just going to increase the size here to 3 so that we can add the player bullet as well as the enemy bullet. And I'm going to create a tag for the bullets. So add tag, create, I'm going to call it bullet. And save. I'm going to give the same tag for both the player bullet and the enemy bullet. And inside our pool manager, I'm just going to change the tag from ammo to bullet. Now let's open up our pool manager. Here in the start method, we have set the prefab to active. This is because earlier we were only creating the ammo pickup and we wanted the ammo pickup to be active on the scene at the start of the game, but we don't want our projectiles to be active at the start of the scene. So I'm going to create a switch, or I'm just going to create a method here and call it set prefab or activate prefab. And we are going to check the tag of the prefab we want to move from our pool to the scene. And for now, if the tag is ammo, we are going to set it to active at the start of the scene. Else, if it is bullet, we are going to set it we are not going to set it to active at the start of the scene. So I'm just going to remove this here. And I'm just going to call the active prefab method we created here. And inside our active prefab, we are going to need to pass a prefab to set it to active. So I'm going to pass it by reference. So it's going to be game object. Prefab. Here we are going to use a switch. We could use an if else, but it is better to use switch when we have multiple objects. Right now we have only bullet and ammo, but we might want to increase this later, so that's why I'm going to use a switch here. And the condition is going to be we are going to check the tag of the prefab. So prefab dot tag, and right now there's going to be two cases. So case one is if the tag is ammo, and if tag is ammo, we set prefab to active. Set active true. Break so that we can exit our switch. And if tag is bullet, we are not gonna set it to active at the start of the scene. So prefab dot set active false. And break. And the default condition should be just a break. And all we need to do here is pass the prefab. Oh, we should pass it by reference. So REF prefab. Now we need to set a projectile to active when a player presses fire or if an enemy tries to shoot. So we could use this method, but then again, we don't want a count or a max variable because enemy or player is going to fire only one projectile at a time. So we could still change things up in here, but I am going to use a different method just because I just want to show you what method overloading is. So we just make a method with the same name, but we give different parameters. Here we are going to still need the tag. We are not going to set our position randomly, so we will need a vector 3 position. Which should be the enemy or the player's position, or from where we are going to shoot a bullet. So that's position. And we also need a quaternion so as to pass the rotation of a player or enemy when it is shooting. So I'm going to call it ROT. And we are still gonna use a pool dictionary tag DQ and object.setActive inside here. And we are gonna set a object.position, transform.position to the post we pass when we call this method. And obj.transform.rotation will be the rotation we pass when we call this method. Now let's get to our movement script. And in our movement script, this is where we instantiate our projectile. So I'm just going to create a boolean here called can shoot and move the requirements for the player to be able to shoot to can shoot. So if all these are satisfied, our can shoot variable will be true, and that's when we will be able to shoot. I just did this so that it is more easy to read our code and understand it. We're not going to use this line because we're not gonna instantiate our projectile anymore. We're just going to move it from our pool to the scene. And inside our pool manager, the spawn method, we are going to need another string, which is our instantiator. So if you haven't watched my previous videos, instantiator is just the tag of the player or the enemy, depending on who is producing the projectile. It's just to check if the projectile has hit the instantiator itself and to not destroy the projectile if it has hit the instantiator. Because for example, if the player is producing the projectile, it's obviously going to hit this cube here, and that is a part of our player and it has got the player tag. So we don't want our projectile to get destroyed if it hits this player tagged object. That's why we are using an instantiator to check if the projectile is hitting the instantiator itself. So now that we have added the instantiator to this, I'm just going to add another line to set the instantiator. That is going to be obj.getComponent projectile. Projectiles dot set instantiator and just pass this variable. And we are not going to use this line of code. Here we are going to need an instance of our pool manager, just as we created in a game manager in the previous video. So if you haven't watched my previous video already, don't worry, I'll put a link in the description. We're just going to make a instance of our pool manager here and use this instance to call our spawn method. So after this, we're just gonna use pool manager.spawn and pass the tag. It's going to be bullet. Then we need to pass the position. That's going to be this spawn position. And we need to pass the rotation of our player. So that's going to be transform.rotation. And the tag of our player, that's just going to be tag. Now let's do the same thing with our enemy controller. And inside our enemy controller, this is where we create an instance of a projectile. So we are not going to need the instance or the setting or the instance dot set instantiator method. So I'm just going to delete those. And just as we did in our movement script, I'm just going to create a pool manager instance. And use this instance. Sorry, it should be setup and start. And use this pool manager instance to call the spawn method. We should pass the tag bullet. The position should be the enemy's transform.position. So transform.position. Rotation is the enemy's transform.rotation. So transform.rotation. And the instance is the tag of our enemy. So just tag. So inside the projectile script was what we used to destroy a projectile when it has passed a certain time on our scene or if it has hit another object. So we are not going to do that anymore. We are just going to pass our projectile into our pool and set it to deactive. So I'm just going to delete these lines. So here I'm going to introduce you to a coroutine. So what a coroutine does is it basically acts like a function, but we got this cool feature to wait for a particular amount of time before moving on to the next code. We use yield return, and all the lines of code before this gets executed sequentially, and when it gets to this yield return, we can choose to pause the function for a certain amount of time, and it checks if the time has passed, and if it has passed, it will move on to the next line of code. So here we are going to use this function to deactivate a projectile from our scene after a certain amount of time has passed by. So here I'm just going to create a coroutine. So I enumerator, I'm gonna call it destroy after, and pass the float variable, which is time that we want to wait before sending a projectile back to the pool. So here we are just gonna use yield return, new, and wait for seconds, and just pass the time we have sent here. And now we are gonna call this coroutine. So this is how we call a coroutine, by using start coroutine. And then just like we call a function. So the function name and pass the parameter. Here we are destroying, we used to destroy our projectile after it has hit an object with a small delay of 0.2 seconds. So I'm just gonna give that here. and we used to destroy our projectile after 15 seconds has passed by. That is our destroy after variable here. So I'm just going to pass that from our update method, and that should be it. So now we go back to Unity and hit play. Our enemy is going to collect the projectile. Let's make a player collector pickup as well. And now we try to shoot. Okay, yeah, we got a problem here. That's basically because we have given the same tag for a bullet and a enemy bullet. That's why both the enemy and the player is producing the same kind of bullet. So I'm just going to open a enemy bullet prefab, add a new tag, and I'm gonna call it enemy bullet. And I'm going to use this tag for our enemy bullet. So we'll also need to change it in our pool manager. So I'm gonna rename this as enemy bullet. And we'll need to change it in our enemy controller, where we call our spawn method. Going to be enemy bullet. And here in our pool manager, now we are going to need a new case for our enemy bullet. Otherwise, it'll just go to default. So I'm just gonna use enemy bullet here. Oh, and we have another problem here. That's we haven't used this pool dictionary tag.nq object in a new spawn method. So I'm just going to paste it here. This is just to add the object instance back to a dictionary inside the queue. And I think that will be good to go now. So now we try to play. Once the enemy has collected the ammo pickup, yeah, I think that it's shooting the correct projectile. Let's just try the player's projectile as well. Yeah, that's working fine. Now another thing we need to do is we need to update the pool manager in our second scene. So let's just quickly do that. So I'm just going to copy the component from our pool manager, go to our second scene, open the pool manager, and paste it here. Paste component values. And that's all we need to do. So let's try it in our second scene as well. So if we hit play on our second scene, and once the enemy has collected one of these ammo pickups, you can see that it is shooting the correct projectile. But one issue we got here is there are only 5 of these enemy bullets on a pool, and they're being shared by 2 of these enemies, so it's really hard for them. So I'm just going to increase the number to 15, and I think that will be good to go. And yeah, so that's it for today's video. Thank you all for watching. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, and smash that like button if you like watching my tutorials. Good luck, peace.